Yeah, so I'm going to talk about a work I was doing over the past year with my two collaborators, Matteo Lostaglio and Chris Perry, Matteo in Barcelona and Chris in Copenhagen. And yeah, it's about sort of connecting two slightly different things. One is heat bath algorithmic cooling, and the other one is thermal operations. I mean, of course, I don't expect you to know what these are, but hopefully this will become clearer. Yeah, a long talk. Yeah. So just let's get straight to the point. So I guess the one thing I want to do here, and I guess you know pretty much everyone in quantum computing wants to do, is to achieve pure states, no, for your computation. So this is going to be the goal here. I guess just the small disclaimer that I want to make is that I'm going to be using the words cooling and purifying completely analogously. So I guess depending on the implementation, you always want to cool the qubits, no, to some particular state like zero state, and in many cases the simple things you can do like doing projective measurements on your states are not going to give you the threshold value that you need. So you need to be a bit smarter, no, with what you do. And this is where sort of the idea of algorithmic cooling comes in, no, to help you in achieving this sort of desired purities that you need. Yeah, for the you know for the threshold basically.
So for that equation, or that expression, should we just think of one single qubit, or
This is just single qubit. Yeah. I mean, of course, you're gonna want a lot of them. No? But I mean, I'm gonna focus on cooling single ones for.
What is the pi?
A projector into the orthogonal space. Yeah, if it's a qubit, yeah. Yeah. So I'm just going to start describing the actual classic scheme of algorithmic cooling. So I believe the original idea is due to Schulman and Bassirani in 1999. And it's actually very, very simple. So the idea is that you have some source of thermal qubits, no? Yeah, they come from a heat bath. And then you can put you know a bunch of them together. And then what you want is you want to act on them in such a way that you get one of them colder and the rest hotter, no? So, yeah. So then the colder one you can use it, no? For yeah, to do whatever you want with it. So what you do is actually some sort of compression scheme, no? Where you have your many qubits and you act with a collective unitary on them, and then the result is that some of them are hotter. These are called the ancilla qubits, and then one is colder, and then the colder one is you know it's colder, so you hopefully will be as cold as you need, no? Yeah, so this is very simple, and then I guess these people working it all, they came up with an extra step that helps you even more, and this is where the heat bath comes in. So what do? You just take this compressed state, and you can realize that you take this the same as in the initial step, and you can realize that actually these qubits are hotter than the original ones in your heat bath, so you can just throw them away and get new ones. And then you can repeat the same process. There should be a U dagger there. And then as you repeat, you know, you're dumping entropy into your bath, so your target one is going to get colder and colder, no? And you just sort of carry on. So this is the original idea. And yeah.
Why do you want to repeat it? Why not just do it once?
Because you're going to get colder in the end. So what you do is you. So here you start with all of them being the same. Then one of them gets colder and the rest get hot. But the hotter ones, you can replace them with colder ones from your bath, no? So then you're back in this stage, and now you can do the same unit. Well, maybe the same unitary, maybe a different one. That sort of does the same thing, no? Again, it pumps the entropy from this into this, so it gets even colder and colder and colder, and you're gonna reach some steady state at some point. So some maximum value you can achieve. So I guess the more you do it, up to some point, the colder this one is gonna be, no? So you do care about the single one here. Yeah, and exactly. You don't make any measurements. Yeah. So if you were able to make a measurement in the first place, then you'll be done. No. So this is, I guess we're assuming you cannot make. This is an assumption of the framework, I guess, that the simple things like making measurements don't work, or at least work worse than this sort of thing. No. Okay. So yeah, I'm just going to summarize a bit a few things that exist in the literature to give context. So these two I've already talked about. So. Yeah, so in this original one, what you do is unitaries on system and ancillas, which is like a compression unitary. So actually, I mean, the idea is just similar to what you do in like Schumacher compression, no? or things like this. And then the extra step is you have a thermal reset on the ancillas. So you take your hot qubits and you make them, you know, you reset them with your thermal bath, so they become slightly colder. And this was analyzed in a number of works. So it was proposed here, but then it's been analyzed actually by many people from IQC, as you can see. So there were some nice numerical results back in 2005, and then Racy and Mosca analyzed the asymptotic behavior of you know, the limit where you do many rounds of this. And then actually Nayeli and Ray here, they managed to do the finite round case, no? And for this, there's this algorithm, which I believe is optimal, which is this PPA algorithm, which I mean, it's just like a particular set of, you know, unitaries that you have to do. I'm not going to get too much into this. And then actually, there was a nice modification of this sort of idea in this paper by Rodriguez Viernes et al. And then they do some sort of modification of this, no? Where you have a system and ancillas, and then you can do unitaries on them. But then actually you change a little bit what the thermal reset means, no? So instead of just resetting this ancilla qubits that you had, what they do is a reset of a virtual qubit. So you can think, for instance, if you have two qubits, the thermal step that you do is you act with your bath in the 0011 subspace, no? So you're not thermalizing one of the qubits, but some sort of subspace of them, no? So I see this actually as some sort of modification of the thermal step, no? That actually gives you a better performance in some cases. So actually, essentially what we do is we take this idea a bit further. And we essentially ask the question of, you know, what happens if you generalize this thermal step? And this is essentially what I want to say here. So the idea we took is we just looked at all these previous works from algorithmic cooling from a perspective that they were sort of part of a unified framework. And this framework includes basically protocols that consist of a few steps. No, the steps are unitaries in your qubits and in your target systems and your ancilla, and then you do interactions with the thermal environment, and then you have these ancillary systems that, you know, you can sort of reuse or you can use in different ways. No, and I guess the one thing the one idea we took from this paper is that, you know, you can actually change this step a little bit and then get better performance. No. So this is the idea we had. No, we essentially what happens if you sort of allow for more freedom in this step, and then
Sorry, I didn't mean to stop you mid-sentence.
Oh no.
But you started describing a system at the very first slides where you sort of have these unitaries that are kind of oblivious to the state, mm-hmm. and you just replace. But now you're going outside that model, and I didn't really understand how mm-hmm. you're changing the model.
Other operations? Yeah, so I guess the one thing that is different is that here what I was doing is just taking these red balls and replacing them with white ones. So this I see as some very particular interaction with a heat bath, which is the very common one of you take a system and you replace it with a thermal state. No?
Okay.
But then maybe you can do something, some other things, actually. And this is the thing we explore,
you
essentially.
Like not put a thermal state in there?
Yeah, have some interaction with some environment, which allows you to do slightly different things.
Well, what if you just set them all to cat zero and it's swap gates, that would be the way
to go? Yeah, but then I guess that's the assumption that we don't have access to this sort of thing, actually. So your bath has a finite temperature that is not zero, basically. If you're able to do that sort of thing, then of course this.
Okay, so they're not thermostates, but they're not completely free. You have some less restrictive property than being a thermostate.
Yeah, so I guess it should be some fixed finite temperature that is sort of high enough that is sort of above what you need, no? Above the, so it's so hot that.
That was a Gibbs state in all these cases.
Yeah.
You're restricted to using Gibbs states.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. 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 Of course. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I guess it's important to set the rules of the game sort of straight, no? Because if you're allowed for something like this, for like three qubits in the ground state, then you're done. If you allow for measurements, then you're done. So, you know. So you have to set up the framework somehow in a way that is sort of meaningful, no? And not trivial. No? Is that clear?
And is there some underlying, sorry for asking all these questions, but the model is really interesting, but so is there some implied sort of energy basis, like, you know, by some energy Hamiltonian so that you know what's hot and what's cold in the background?
Like, yeah.
Some implicitly part of the situation?
Yeah, I think there is, because the qubits have an energy eigenbasis and you're thermalizing with respect to these Hamiltonians, no?
Okay, so can any Hamiltonian for the energy?
In principle, yeah.
With to that.
Well, I guess the previous model sort of, I don't know if it's generic to all of the, but this works assume that they're not interacting. So the thermal states are sort of product states. I'm not sure how crucial this is, actually, but That's one assumption. I guess maybe you can change it. Actually, it's not going to be very important for what I'm going to say. I was already here. I guess the idea here is just that, you know, we just ask, what if you allow for things that are just not thermal reset? And then, you know, the problem with this is that you need to somehow have a framework that is consistent in such a way that you don't get just like very trivial answers or very, you know, meaningless answers. You know, maybe there's some freedom you can allow for, but then like Richard said, maybe you just end up with like, you know, doing swaps with a state that is already cool, so we don't want this. But actually the nice thing is that we have a framework for like a very general set of interactions between systems and baths. And this resource theoretic framework of thermal operations. So the idea is that we take this framework of thermal operations, which is a resource theory, and then we just use it for these protocols. No? Let me tell you a bit more about this. What are these thermal operations? So I guess in the same way that most of you have studied at some point the theory of entanglement, no? So the theory of entanglement is a resource theory, no? Where the resource is entanglement, and then you have the free operations, which do not create entanglement, which are just local operations and classical communication. No? So it turns out that you can actually build a very similar structure, but for understanding thermal properties of systems, and also, I guess, non-equilibrium properties of quantum systems. And this is actually the framework of thermal operations. So this was defined in these few papers. So there's a very early one by Jaynes et al., but actually the ones that sort of started the whole thing were these two. In 2013. And then the idea there is that we also have a set of free operations that constitute somehow interactions with a thermal bath, no? So what are these thermal operations? So it's a set of CPTP maps, no? And it's defined in this way, through this sort of steam spring form. So it's a set of channels acting on a system. And essentially what you do is you take a thermal bath, which is arbitrary, and then you apply a unitary. Which is arbitrary up to this constraint here, which is that, you know, there's a Hamiltonian for this system, there's a Hamiltonian for this bath, and then the unitary has to conserve the energy exactly. And well, of course, you can put epsilons here as well, but this is sort of the simple definition.
So conserve the energy means commute with a.
Commuting with the sum of the local ones, yeah. Yeah.
Alvaro, the previous algorithm you mentioned.
Mm-hmm. I think they do, because if the Markovian, so I interpret this sort of step, I interpret it as some sort of weak Markovian coupling with your bath, no?
But the first operation doesn't have.
This one? Oh, no, this one doesn't, no. But I guess the point is that, the first one is this one, but the one I'm changing is the second one. So this one is going to be beyond the resource theory. This one is going to be the resource in the protocol. But this is the one we changed, and this is the free. So this is, you can think of this as the resource you put in, like the work you put into your protocol, and this is the free operation. That's sort of how we conceptualize this. This idea. And then you need to be careful, of course, because the unitary introduces some resource, and yeah, you just have to take it into account. But this is fine. So I was here.
So we don't have to commute with HS and with HB, just with the sum.
With the sum, yeah. So what it does really is that it sort of swaps around the degenerate subspaces in energy of the two. No? Yeah. It's not super straightforward to see, but anything that is all these master equations, like Lindblad master equations that take you to a thermal state, actually are part of this set. I mean, this is somehow like this looks a lot like weak coupling actually, and in fact weak coupling is included here. So the idea of allowing for this more general definition is that we go beyond weak coupling and beyond Markovian interactions with your bath. So as I will explain later, actually what happens here is that we're able to use non-Markovianity in some way. So some properties that are important for this set is that, well, it's a fairly natural set of system bath interactions. These are sort of physically motivated constraints, you know, some energy conservation. It's a convex set, and I will use this later. And of course, it has a well understood structure in the sense that, you know, we've been actually working with these sort of models for a very long time. And for instance, we have a fairly good understanding of the sort of possible transitions between states that we're able to do. Like in entanglement, you have these majorization conditions, for instance. We have similar things there. we have some idea of what's the sort of partial order of states induced by this set of maps. And then one caveat, which I will come back to, and is I think quite important one in when you start applying these ideas to more practically motivated things, is that these definitions are actually very general, no? In the sense that here I haven't specified anything about the size of the bath, no? And I haven't specified anything about the complexity of the unitary. So here I'm going to include things that are very complicated baths over which we have very, very fine-grained access, no? So of course you can include things that are completely unfeasible, no? In practice. And we want to avoid this, and I will show how you can do this for particular cases and for the ones we care about, actually. So yeah, so this is the framework that we work in, which we work in.
Again, but what are the conditions that you're given as the problem, and what are you allowed to choose? Like, do you select what the HB is?
I can select the HB and the U. Yeah. So now here, instead of just saying I take my Hamiltonian of the system and I thermalize it, yeah. Now I have more freedom. I can choose. Well, I have the Hamiltonian of the system, but I can choose the Hamiltonian of the bath and the unitary. And some of them are going to be non-Markovian, for instance. Some of them are not going to be just take your system and thermalize it. They're going to be more complicated.
But isn't it possible to make choices so that I can actually just have like a cat zero and do a swap?
No, because this bath. Well, okay, I guess this bath could have a very large energy gap. Yeah, and then you could swap. Let me see. Oh, no, actually, no, because, okay, so imagine, for instance, if you had, so this could be close to a ground state, if this is a qubit, and then the Hamiltonian has a very, very large energy gap, no? But because of this condition, you cannot just do the swap. Because your energy gap is too large, so you're not going to be able to swap with your qubit, which has a very small gap, because this condition doesn't allow you to do this swap. Doesn't, no. Hmm. Yeah. Yeah, no, yeah, actually, no. For sure, no. Any questions about this? Okay, so now I'm just going to repeat what we do once more. So we take our protocols to be made of a few rounds. So you do a unitary on your target system, maybe on some ancillas. Then you do one of these thermal operations on your system and maybe also on the ancillas. And then you just repeat. And then we have a few questions, no? That we can answer. What is the optimal unitary? What is the optimal thermal operation? How can you do it? Meaning, what is U and what is H? What type of interactions do we need? And also, well, how does it compare to other things? No? So these are the questions I'm going to answer, mostly for qubits. But later on in the talk, I should be able to do the qubit case. Just a quick word about the actual optimization that we can do. So it's essentially how this goes is that we have to take a bunch of results existing from this resource theory framework, in particular these two actually. In the simplest instance of the protocol, we just look at single qubits. So actually we end up only having to optimize over 2x2 matrices, which is of course very simple. So in the end, actually the optimization it's not trivial to get to it, but it boils down to like finding the maximum of a parabola or something like this. Anyway, I don't want to get too much into that. I'll just go straight to the optimal protocol. So the optimal protocol, again, is a unitary and a thermal operation, which you repeat. So what does this look like? First, I guess I insisted before that in the previous protocols, there was a system and there were ancillas that you could use, no, to pump the entropy into them. But actually, because I'm allowing for this extra freedom now, I can actually have quite non-trivial protocols that don't use these ancillas. So I think it's not a bad idea to just look at the single qubit case, no? So essentially, the picture I had before, in which I only consider I have only one, no? Only one of these, I don't have the other balls because of this extra freedom, no? So how does it go? So imagine I start my qubit in a thermal state of some temperature, this is the energy gap, and then the unitary is a Pauli X, population inversion, which just maps this one here and this one there, no? And then the thermal operation is something we call a beta swap. So I guess the best way to understand it is as a stochastic matrix that preserves the Gibbs distribution of this qubit, and it has this form. Actually, if you know what the Metropolis algorithm is, this is actually kind of doing the same thing. So what this does actually is that if you're in the excited state, it takes you to the ground state with probability 1, and if you're in the ground state, it takes you to the excited state with some probability. And there's some thermal factor there. This bit a swap because essentially in the limit of infinite temperature, it becomes a swap, like a Pauli, actually. and then what I'm saying is that if you repeat this many, many, many times, you get an optimal algorithm. And actually, the performance that you get is this one here. So what is this? So you start with some initial ground state population, maybe this thermal one. And then after k rounds, you converge to one. So this is the population after k rounds. You converge to one exponentially in the number of rounds. And this is the exponent here is the temperature times the gap of a qubit. So actually, with just a single qubit, without ancillas, you end up reaching one. As in perfectly the ground state, no? Sort of asymptotically in the number of rounds. and any other unitary you do, and any other thermal operation you do is going to be worse. This we can prove. So this may be strange to you, but hopefully it'll be a bit less after this slide.
What does it mean in the case of infinite temperature like that?
This?
Then it's just a swap gate,
you said? Well, it's just, yeah, so this will be a one, no?
Yeah.
And then this is 0, 1, 1, 0. So it's just doing the same as the Pauli, I guess. Although, well, one thing, be careful, is that this is a unitary and this is a stochastic matrix. So they don't act on the quantum state the same way. Yeah. This acts only on the diagonal, no? I haven't told you what it does to the other diagonal. But in the end, they just swap the ground state and the excited state. So actually, what this is doing really is swapping the ground state and the excited state, but with some sort of thermal ratio, no? So it's not quite doing it, no? And this thermal bias is what ends up doing the cooling for you. Actually, it just takes the off diagonal and maps it to zero. So it's completely coherent.
Okay, so this matrix acts?
So the thermal operation is a CPTP map, no? But actually, one property of these thermal operations is that you can look at what they do to the diagonal of the states, diagonal in the energy eigenbasis, as a stochastic matrix. Okay, so they do something to the populations and they do something different to the coherences. And of course, these things are coupled, no? Because of complete positivity. But it turns out that this one, what it does is that it maps, so you have some state arbitrary, and you can write it in the energy eigenbasis. It maps the coherence to zero, and then it maps the population to whatever the image of this stochastic matrix is. So you can see that if you input the thermal populations here, you get the same, no? Because actually this preserves the Gibbs state, no? Still. is the energy gap of your qubit. It's defined here, I guess. This is the definition of delta.
You don't have control over it.
No, just choose it, yeah.
Yep. So how will we implement this data swap?
I'll come back to that later. There's a slide about this in a couple of, yeah. good question. one thing I want to say about this, so about this equation in particular, is the following. So I was saying that we cool to the ground state, no? So I guess you might want to ask, how is this related to, you know, there's like sort of no-go theorems for this, no? How is this related to the third law of thermodynamics? Which basically says that you cannot cool to the ground state, no? So one way to look at the third law, actually, especially in this resource theory setting, this has been studied in these couple of papers, in particular this one, I quite like it, is that the statement is that you cannot cool to the ground state with finite resources. But here we're introducing a resource, like I said a bit earlier, you have the Pauli X, and you can think of this Pauli X as introducing a little bit of work in your system. In particular, plus or minus delta, no? Because you're doing this population inversion. No? So with some probability you're exciting, with some probability you're de-exciting. So then we can actually compare our performance to the one you get from the third law. And actually, what this paper gives us is some sort of converse to our algorithm. And actually, we kind of saturated this converse statement because, as you can see, we have an upper bound on the achievable ground state population, and they're exactly the same equation up to this constant here, which is smaller than one. So asymptotically, this is the best we can do, first because we optimize, but also because we sort of saturate this converse, which I think is nice. I mean, this constant is actually kind of small. It's like 10 to the minus 2 or 10 to the minus 3, but yeah. So I thought that was kind of nice to mention.
Maybe you'll address it later, but how is it? How is it quantitative? Like if you want to get within epsilon of the ground state, you say what the resources are?
Yeah, exactly. So it tells you if you want to get epsilon close, you need this much work or this much something else. Well, then, actually, all I'm going to say about this is this equation, really. So this is the statement of the third law here, which is that you're bounded by this quantity here that depends on how much work you put. So the k tells you, k times delta tells you how much work you put, because every round you're putting somehow plus or minus delta. And actually, for this, you have to look at the worst case. So you have to look at the case where you add sort of delta every round. No? That's why you get the k delta. That's all I'm going to say. So if you have more questions.
Where are you bounding? What's this peak? Like, what's this the quantity of how close you are to the ground state?
Oh, this is the ground state population. So this you want this to be one.
The ground state population.
So the probability that you have in the ground state.
Okay.
Yeah. This is the one I achieve, and this is the one, and this is the bound I have on it. Which, of course, this bound would be trivial if this was one, no? But it's smaller than one, no? So what I'm saying is that this number is smaller than one, but it's very close to this one. This one is smaller than one, of course, as well.
Oh.
But they're somehow quite close. Mm-hmm. So now back to the other question of how you do the beta swap. So actually, we know that I was saying you have to define a u, you have to define an h of the bath. But actually, we know how we can do it. So one thing we know is actually we only need a harmonic oscillator to be this environment that you use in the thermal operation, a harmonic oscillator which is resonant with your qubit. And then you need, for the beta swap, you need a particular interaction Hamiltonian. I mean, it's not necessarily the only one that achieves it, but I think it's the simpler one we found. And it's some sort of like light matter interaction here. So you have, I mean, I guess maybe you've seen this sort of thing before. This is like the resonant Jaynes Cummings. So this is a modification of it, where you have this little intensity dependence in the coupling. No? So this, I think people call these things the intensity dependent Jaynes Cummings model. So with this, you can achieve the beta swap perfectly. Now, I'm not completely sure how easy it is to achieve this one, to realize this interaction. So you can also look at how well you can do with the Jaynes Cummings, which is a very common thing. And it turns out that we can do, you can get, so if you parameterize these matrices with a parameter lambda, where a lambda equals one corresponds to the beta swap, you can get, depending on the parameters, you can get lambda to be like 0.98 or something like this. So one thing we can study is how robust is our protocol to imperfections in this matrix. So if you have 0.98, and it turns out that it's fairly robust in the sense that if you don't get a one, you don't achieve population one. So this one changes to something smaller than one, sorry, this one here. And there's a correction here that depends on lambda. But somehow it's sort of robust to these errors, no? So if your lambda is small, then your asymptotic population is going to be close to one. So lambda is a parameter that tells you how close you are to the beta swap. So these are the you can think of these as the thermal operations, so the thermal step in the protocol, and they're parameterized by this parameter lambda. No, so lambda goes from 0 to 1. So 0 is the identity, and 1 is this one. So yeah, so it goes from 0 to 1, and basically I want to achieve the highest possible lambda. So the higher, actually I'm going to say the higher the lambda, the better you cool, because of this, no? So the higher the lambda, if you're close to one, then this becomes zero, no? So looking at the Jaynes Cummings interaction, you know, we have some sort of vague proposal for what an experiment of this protocol will look like, which is the following. So you have your initial state, and you apply a Pauli X to it, and you fire it through some cavity, which is at some temperature, so it interacts with Hamiltonian like this. And then it comes out, and you do the same. You apply Pauli X, and then you do another interaction with the cavity, and then Pauli X, and then interaction, and so on. And then, if these interactions are timed in such a way that you achieve a high lambda, which is the important thing here, to achieve a high lambda because of this, then you should be able to cool quite well. Yeah. Yeah. So this Hamiltonian will be the Hamiltonian of a resonant mode in the cavity here. Oh, sorry, these are the interactions. So this will be the interaction that generates the unitary of the thermal operation, this one, right? So it's the coupling between the system and the environment. Right. So this unitary is generated by the Jaynes Cummings.
Okay. Yeah. And the other Hamiltonian?
And the other Hamiltonian is this. Oh, sorry. Oh, well, there are two different. So I have two Hamiltonians because I have sort of two different ways of doing this unitary. And one is better and the other one is worse, but one is sort of a bit more strange. And the other one is just Jaynes Cummings. So that's. This? Yeah.
Yeah, this one would give you exactly the value as what they want?
Yeah. I mean you have to time the interaction time. So you have to be careful, but yeah.
So I've never seen a dagger square root one square root of this.
Yeah.
I'm not really sure what it's one square root of a and a dagger, but you say this one would give you the exact
this, yeah.
But the other one
doesn't.
Is
exactly, yeah, because we know this one is not going to achieve the one. There's a bound, actually, on how well this does.
Okay. But this one we've seen that exists as I've seen it.
This one?
Yeah,
yeah, exactly. So that's why I wanted to mention it. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, so okay, in that case, that's a typo, yeah. Yeah, so what should happen is that the atom gets excited and the mode gets excited, yeah.
Yeah, so.
Okay, sorry, yeah. I guess you're right, yeah. Yeah, I guess you're right. I'm really bad at thinking about these things on the spot. But yes, it's how you say it, for sure. Anyway, so this is the. So, okay, one more thing I want to say is that actually, this achieving this high lambda. It's actually the same thing you need in the interactions you require between atoms and cavities in the micromaser, which is something people have been studying since the 80s. So I guess optimizing for lambda is not something completely unreasonable. Okay, so one more thing I want to say is about this non-Markovianity that I mentioned before. So we do introduce an amount of non-Markovianity in the thermal interaction with your environment, which now is going to be just a harmonic oscillator. And I want to make this a bit more precise. So something we know is that actually, if you restrict your thermal operations to be Markovian, the value of lambda you can achieve, so the lambda being the parameter in this thermal operation, in this stochastic matrix, is upper bounded by this number, which is actually just some thermal population. So Markovianity tells you can only do this much. And actually, for our kind of protocols, this is very bad. This doesn't do anything. Yeah, it ends up basically not cooling at all. No?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. The lambda will be exactly this. The difference is that you use ancillas. When you use ancillas, then you can actually
improve that.
You can do something with this lambda.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, but without ancillas, which is the case we're looking at here, you cannot do anything basically. So the ancillas are crucial for the if you only have Markovian interactions, the ancillas are necessary basically. Yeah. So actually, something we know is that Markovian tells you that your lambda is within this regime only, and then non-Markovian interactions are this other set actually. Well, I guess this is not completely one to one because you can have things here that are still non-Markovian, but things here are definitely non-Markovian, and and the higher you are in the more you are towards one, the better you cool. No, so there's some sort of this very precise sense in which Markovianity is necessary. I don't want to claim that being here is more non-Markovian than being here. I don't think this will be accurate. But I'm just saying that Markovianity is necessary. Yeah. Okay, so now we have some numbers to compare with the previous ones. So I showed in the first couple of slides the four protocols that we consider, and they're just plotted here. So the older one, this PPA algorithm for 3 qubits, we plot it as this purple curve. I hope the colors are okay. So this purple curve here, and this is the number. So this is the number of rounds, and this is the ground state population you achieve. Okay. And then there's this other one, which was done by Nayeli and Ray and other people, which is this one where you do this thermal reset in 0011. This would be the green curve. And then our protocols are the red and the blue. So the blue is the optimal one, in which you use this Hamiltonian, and then you do this beta swap. And the red one, there's two curves. And actually, it's because we weren't able to compute exactly the performance. We have upper and lower bounds. But it's the one you will achieve with the Jaynes Cummings interaction. So something that was a bit unexpected to us, and I don't have an explanation for it, is that the green curve is always in between the red curves. No idea why. But I guess what we see is that if you use this simple Jaynes Cummings interaction, you can do sort of, depending on the parameter regime, you can do comparably well with the green, with the algorithm in the green, you know, which was the one with this non-local reset. And then the blue protocol, the optimal one, always does better for all parameter regimes. So you know, I think you know, of course, you have to be careful with the parameter regimes. So, but you know, in many cases, it seems that at least we can do as well as this one, no? And in other cases, better, of course. But I mean, this, of course, if you want to actually do these experiments, you have to be very careful, no, with the parameter regimes, with many details, and so on. So I just take this, you know, with a, you know, some sort of proof that this may work, no, not that it works. Okay, so I think I have time to actually go. So all I said so far is actually for very simple. No, it's just 2x2 matrices, it's single qubits. And actually, I wanted to focus on this quite a lot because I think it's the simplest and the possibly useful one. No? But actually, we have generalizations of all these things for arbitrary amounts of energy levels. Yeah. So now I want to focus actually on protocols on qubits, where the idea is the same. So now I have some Hamiltonian system which has D levels, and I can do unitaries on these D levels. I can do thermal operations. Actually, one thing is that I don't know exactly. So one thing we don't have yet in the resource theory is for D levels, is how the thermal operations act on the coherences. So I'm just going to assume that the system is sort of decohered from the start. But I don't think this is a big problem. And then you just repeat, no? So you have essentially the same thing, but for more levels. No? And one thing is that you can start now considering ancillas, no? Because you can think of your D levels as being your system plus the ancillas. No? but it also works if you have a D level system. No? OK, so I can present the actual optimal algorithm. No? For this, we ended up needing a bit more complicated techniques that I will explain in a second. But the protocol is completely analogous to the one in qubits. So what you do is you do this unitary, which does a population inversion. So what it does is you have some initial thermal state, for instance, and you invert the populations, meaning you put the population you had in the ground state, which is very high, you put it in the most excited state, no? And then the second largest to the second most excited state. So essentially what you end up with is a state, you know, for which the largest eigenvalue of this density matrix belongs to the most excited energy state of your Hamiltonian. And this we call maximally active state max active is like it's consistent with some terminology in quantum thermodynamics. Is this clear? Okay, because this is important actually. And then what we do is we do a particular extremal thermal operation, extremal in the sense that, you know, they're a convex set, so we can choose an extremal point of this convex set, and then you just repeat, and then you end up close to the ground state. Very close, in fact. You do something exponentially close in the number of rounds. Okay, and actually I want to show you a bit of the proof ingredients of these things, because I think there's one in particular that is kind of interesting. So actually one thing we use is some sort of generalization of the Schur-Horn theorem, which I will explain briefly for those of you who don't know. So for this, I have to explain what is majorization. So majorization is a mathematical tool, which is essentially a preorder in the space of probability distributions. So it tells you which probability distributions are closer to the uniform distribution. So I call the closer you are to the uniform distribution, more noisy, and the other ones, less noisy. So this symbol means that this majorizes this, and also that this is less noisy than this. So what does it mean exactly? It means that if this state majorizes this one, there exists a stochastic matrix, which is in fact doubly stochastic, meaning that both the columns and the rows add up to one, such that it maps the initial population to the final one. So this is a very precise sense in which this probability distribution is less mixed than this one, no? Because a mixing map, you know, maps one to the other. So this is a very, you know, accurate definition of what it means to be less or more noisy. So the Schur-Horn theorem essentially tells me that if I take an arbitrary density matrix, I can look at two different probability distributions. One is the diagonal of this state, and the other one is the eigenvalues of this state. So this theorem tells me essentially that the eigenvalues majorize, meaning are less noisy than the diagonal. And this is any diagonal. So if you rotate the state by some unitary, you're going to get a different probability distribution. This is still going to be more noisy than the eigenvalues of the state. No? So the diagonal is always more noisy than the eigenvalues. Think of a pure state. No? A pure state, this would be 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, and then this could be anything else, which of course is more noisy, more uniform than 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So yeah, so this is a very well-known result, but we have a thermal version of this. And it involves these max active states that I mentioned earlier. So now I have a generalization of majorization, which has to do with thermal states. And this is thermal majorization, which is a key idea in this resource theory framework, actually. So now I have a similar preorder of a state of probability distributions, but now this tells me this thermal majorizes this if this is less thermal than this other one. And now the only thing that changes is that here, instead of having ones here, I have thermal factors. So this you can interpret as my stochastic matrix maps uniform distributions to uniform distributions. This is that it maps thermal distributions to thermal distributions, no? But apart from that, it's exactly the same. So I'm claiming there's an analog of this, of this Schur-Horn theorem. It's a bit more awkward to state, I guess. So now what you have to do is you have to take the eigenvalues of your density matrix, and you have to map your largest eigenvalue to the largest energy level, your second largest eigenvalue to the second largest energy level, and so on. So you essentially get this sort of state, right? So what I'm claiming now is that this distribution, this energy distribution, is the farthest you can be from a thermal state in the unitary orbit of this state. So if I take an arbitrary state, I can do this maximally active state, and then any other unitary that I do in this state is going to take me to a state that is less thermal. Sorry, closer to thermal. So this maximally active state thermomerizes any other state that I can do with a unitary. So I think this is a new thing that we derive, and we use it quite crucially in the generalization of our protocol. Are there any questions about this one?
So you say you've got a proof of this?
Of this, yeah. It's not super complicated, actually. We end up having to use the Schur-Horn itself to prove it. And as far as I know, I mean, maybe it's not new because these people have been studying these things, but we didn't find one in the literature. So actually now with this, I can use another result from this resource theory framework, which is this key theorem by Horodesky and Oppenheim that has appeared before. And basically what this tells me is that if one state thermomerizes the other, in this particular sense, there is a thermal operation that takes me from one to the other. So you I don't want to state this very precisely because I don't think it's that necessary, but the idea of this is that there's some sort of almost one-to-one correspondence between these stochastic matrices, like the one for the beta swap as well. The beta swap will fit into this for two levels, and the set of thermal operations, the set of quantum channels. No? So there's some sort of correspondence between these quantum channels and these stochastic matrices. And then this theorem also connects it with the populations in the energy eigenbasis. So actually, this is sort of the key thing we need for the general algorithm, and I will explain the steps now. So then we end up having to use the thermal Schur-Horn theorem to find what is exactly the unitary that we have to do in the cooling protocol. So of course, the unitary is going to be that which adds the most resource to your state, which of course is going to be this maximally active state, no? And the theorem, the thermal Schur-Horn theorem guarantees that this max active state is the most thermal you can get, so it's the best you can achieve. And then after you reach this state, you can apply a thermal operation, and hopefully because of this Schur-Horn theorem, the set of states that you can reach is very large, and in particular it's going to contain some states that have very large support in the ground state. So, and this thermal operation it's kind of a long proof to construct it, but we can build the explicit stochastic matrix, no? With many coefficients involving linear combinations of thermal factors and so on, and also many zeros. And we know that it has to be an extremal point as well. So the way the algorithm works, I can explain it with this figure here, which is essentially the state space. This is just three levels, no? And then it's like a classical state space of a Q-treat. So what do we do? We take an initial state, we map it, we do a unitary, we map it to the maximally active state, you know, so that it has the highest population in the highest energy level and so on. And then we have this orange region, which I interpret as a set of states that can be reached with thermal operations. And it has extremal points, and these extremal points are realized by, you know, some extremal thermal operation. And then what we do is we just choose the one that takes us to the point that is closer to the ground state. This is how it goes. Of course, as you can see, it's a bit more, it's a bit more mathematical and involved than the qubit one. So I guess this one is more for the technical interest rather than the practical interest. Also, because probably these things for D levels are not so easy to realize. Like you cannot just do Jaynes Cummings and things like this. This is much harder. And in fact, we don't really know. My claim is that this is also optimal if you consider sequences of unitaries and thermal operations and so on. One thing I have, and this is the last thing I'm going to show you actually, is I have a simpler algorithm than this one, which is suboptimal, but still does pretty well. And hopefully, it will show you a bit what's going on with these D levels. So actually, what we can do is another generalization of this qubit protocol. So I take my initial state, and then I apply a unitary that swaps the population of the ground state and the most excited state. So this one goes here, this one goes there. And then I do a sequence of beta swaps. First in these two levels, then in these two levels, then in these two levels. So this I can do with this sort of quasi Jaynes Cummings model. No? So then this, if you do this many times, this converges to the ground state as well. And actually that's so in an exponential way. And here I have instead the energy gap of the whole Hamiltonian. So this is just telling you that there's another, so this is a generalization of the qubit protocol, and this is another one, which is not optimal, but it's sort of simpler. But that's sort of just something I wanted to point, I guess. Okay, so with this, I think I'll just like to conclude with a few comments. So I guess the thing we've done here is we just add some extra ingredient to this framework of algorithmic cooling, and then we find the fairly simple algorithms with something that looks like a good performance. Of course, then if you want to use this in experiments, you have to be careful, no, with how you apply these things and with parameter regimes and so on. but we sort of introduce this extra freedom and this extra tool that you can maybe use in your cooling protocols, no? So why the resource theory picture? Well, because it gives us a good framework of what kind of things are maybe possible to do, or what sort of things are physically reasonable, let's say. and then also we understand them very well, so it was a natural thing for us to follow. And actually, one thing I want to comment about this is that this is somehow a new way of using this resource theory framework. So actually, so far I guess all the research along these lines has been just very theoretical, very abstract. But actually, we showed that you can, if you change your sort of way of looking at it in some way, you can actually use it for practical things. No, so what we do is we take our sort of very theoretical knowledge of all these free operations and so on, and we have some slightly new perspective on it, I guess, and then we manage to apply it to some practical problem. No, I'm not saying this is necessarily the best way in which you can use this sort of set of tools, but I think we find a new way of using this set of tools, if that makes sense. So I guess one hope I have is that people pick up on this and then find similar tasks, well, different tasks in which you can use these sort of optimization techniques. Even just for other resource theories, maybe, you know, this sort of optimizing over free operations because you understand them very well is something maybe you can also do for other cases, for other resource theories, or for, other thermodynamic tasks. I don't know. And then, well, I guess the big open question here is that I don't really know how to answer very well so far, is whether there's a, I guess you have to be careful, no? Because you have to really be able to apply this very precisely. Is the parameter regime in which you're able to apply this the one in which you actually want to cool? Is it not? So there's a lot of open questions that you need to answer before this actually gets applied, let's say. No? But I mean, hopefully this is some sort of avenue that is worth exploring, I think. But for this, you need a lot of sort of more practical knowledge that the three of us don't really have at the moment. So if you have any comments about this, I'll be very, very glad to hear. and with this, I would like to conclude. So thanks a lot for listening. Markovian.
Can you get the optimal result if you are no non-Markovian or you respect the Markovian?
Yeah. Let me see. So how will this look like? I think it may depend exactly on the details of the setting, actually. Let me see. I guess if with that you mean, for instance, just doing thermal resets, I think so. Because in the end, you just have to optimize over the unitaries, no? So you have to look for the unitaries that do the best thing. Actually, it was sort of an open question I had in the first slide there. So the protocol that you and Nayeli had, whether this was optimal. But then actually, for this to make sense, you have to sort of consider the set of operations that you're allowed to do, no? Which it wasn't clear to me what was exactly the general framework of your protocol, actually. But if you're able to define one, then it should be OK to, you know, what are exactly the, you know, can you do a thermal reset in 0011? But also you can do it in 0100, you know, maybe you can consider all these possible combinations, and there I think you can answer. But you know, you have to define some larger set of operations first. Yeah. But I think you can probably use the tools we use in some way. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And actually I would say this optimality of the PPA algorithm, in the end I think for it you just have to argue things about majorization. So, you know, it's I would say it's a similar kind of, you know, you can always sort of extend these arguments to other cases. So, yeah.
Can you show the optimality for the single qubit? Can you show it for the second qubit as well?
So I have this algorithm here. Okay. For this. This is a proof, yeah. So this is the proof of this is optimal. So any unitary you do is going to be worse, and this is guaranteed by this theorem. And then if you choose the thermal operation well enough, this is also, I haven't said too much about what this thermal operation is, but we can write it down explicitly. So this is a proof, yeah. Yeah. And the key ingredient is this, actually. It's really this.